So this presentation draws on a biography I'm completing on Terence McKenna for MIT Press, which chronicles the life, works, and legacy of this psychedelic philosopher. The book covers a lot of ground, but it has one of its 15 chapters on McKenna's role as raving raconteur, addressing his involvement in the early 90s rave scene, with rave becoming a stage for his stand-up philosophy. While writing this book, I became interested in the popular desire within psychedelic electronica to sample the voice of McKenna, whose voice today remains one of the most sampled in music productions. Over 30 years, his voice has been amplified, filtered, and interpreted in a world in which McKenna's mind became iconic for going out of one's mind. So I'm interested here in the way McKenna's voice has been sampled, not only for the transmission of distinct messages, but as a medium for altered states of consciousness. And I want to address how this development suggests an aesthetic we might call McKenna-esque. The year is 1992, and the single Re-Evolution by acid house crossover act The Shaman became one of the strangest hits to ever make the top 20 UK singles chart. What was so strange was the presence of McKenna, who raves right through the 8.5 minute track. McKenna champions rave culture as the shockwave of an apocalyptic revitalization movement.
We will be privileged to see the greatest release of compressed change probably since the birth of the universe. The 20th century is the shudder that announces the approaching cataracts of time over which our species and the destiny of this planet is about to be swept.
And ravers are celebrated on the same track by a figure coming over like the Jim Jones of pop.
These are the last minutes of human history, folks. The countdown is on. This is not a test. We're leaving this world behind for a brighter, better world that has always existed in our imagination.
Integral to McKenna's mythopoetics is his encounter with entities, so-called machine elves from hyperspace. In Berkeley in 66, McKenna first smoked the powerful tryptamine molecule DMT, a disembodied experience in which he encounters the machine elves. I'll play a short video made by Peter Bergman in which McKenna recounts an incident in 1966 in the Berkeley rooming house he managed.
So this woman lets herself in and comes and beats with her clenched fist on my bedroom door. Well, I like underwent a coronary thrombosis or something, and I was in the elf space, and they were screeching and chattering and showing me all this stuff. And when she did this, I flew off bed. I jumped like 2 feet in the air and landed on my feet, and it was as though, and don't try this at home, folks, it was as though this sudden flash of adrenaline and this sudden movement that I made broke up the ordinary division between the trip and normality or something. Anyway, I pulled the trip with me into the room. I was now standing in the room, eyes open, but the elf creatures had come with me, and everything had just been like jacked up to some immense level of intensity, and there were these rotating geometric things in the room hanging in the air, and it was like moving in this jerky motion. This thing was going click, 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 and it was faceted, and every time it would make this large metallic click, these plastic triangle-shaped, brightly colored chits or something, like little pieces of floor tile or something, would fly across the room. And each one of them had a letter on it in an alien language, sort of like Hebrew or Sanskrit. And it was just, there were several of these machines, and these things were ricocheting off the walls, and I had an elf hanging off each hand, and I was turning around, and I was just saying, holy shit, you know, and then she's still beating on the door, you know? So I stagger over to the door, fling it back, and look at her and say something like, Wei duquam waxi ho wani quam haptikupukichning. And then she realized at that point what my problem was and retreated. But I've never forgotten. It's the one time that they went literary on me, and not only did I see them, not only did I hear them, but they were printing on the air the message as well. Very curious.
So McKenna had answered the door, speaking his elf chatter as a kind of primitive language he was compelled to speak when taking tryptamine-based molecules like DMT and psilocybin mushrooms. It was a language he was further compelled to emulate before widening audiences. McKenna called this a visible language and explained that when speaking it, he was experiencing what he called the source of meaning before it is contextually located. It felt like meaning but could not be interpreted through any available dictionary. It was noetic. He called this noesis the shadow thrown by a hyperdimensional object.
Zi ding quap maktiki pitechk feng hua de molde ruf nubk henget e faps titulchk fem bedigen hegeng tektechk.
Emitting these weird small mouth noises, to use McKenna's parlance, he felt he was engaged with a three-dimensional language. When one is speaking this visible language, he once said, you're just rotating this thing, going into it, expanding it, taking it apart, melting it, fusing it, remaking it. In 1993, the elf chatter was emulated as part of live San Francisco performance Alien Dreamtime, produced by Spacetime Continuum, and became integral to the Speaking in Tongues EP. McKenna elaborates on his strange obsessions in the following video.
On DMT, some people, and I'm one of them, speak in strange languages spontaneously. They don't even, in some cases, know they're doing it. They just seem to fall into this. And it's ecstatic to do for some reason. This is just an incredibly, it's what you want to do. It seems to be the obvious thing to do, to speak in this peculiar way. And at first I heard it for years, moving so fast. Just, it was like, I called it elf chatter. And then, I don't know why, diligent prayer or something was able to slow it down. And I found I could do it. And I went out to Hawaii years ago and took a voice-activated tape recorder, and I spent a week. I took 8 grams of mushrooms every night, nearly every night for a week, and made these recordings. And what I came down with were these recordings, which people find extremely alarming to listen to. They hear it, and they just are convinced. They're not like
it's not like, well, it just makes people think you're crazy. They just say, you know, okay, so you were sitting in a tent halfway up a mountain all by yourself, and what you chose to do was shriek in Nostratic for some reason. Now, I still think that the secret of the psychedelics, or the point of all this, has to do with the language.
Also in 1993, Zavaya sampled McKenna on their album Dream Matrix Telemetry. The album attempts to depict the DMT experience, narrated by McKenna, who conveys a psychedelic rite of passage in which the gnome-like artisans, as he called them, essentially teach him to sing a transdimensional language.
I somehow shattered the membrane between myself and ordinary space. I carried the trip into the room with me. An elf hanging off each hand.
The Xenolinguistics also appeared on Zuvaya's Tribal Breakbeats track, The Whisper in Trees. McKenna died in 2000, aged 53, but long after his passing, electronic musicians have manipulated his voice. More than any other individual in the history of electronica, a familiar sonorous wilt is filtered, distorted, enhanced, accelerated, slowed down. Cobbling together audio from a vast archive of spoken word material, digital alchemists reanimate McKenna to create epic audio narratives of dream travel, soul flight, and cosmic transit. At events worldwide, from the 90s through to the present, producers and DJs have sculpted a vibe infused with McKenna. His voice is sampled so frequently in psychedelic trance productions that an alien anthropologist landing at these events might believe that they're witnessing transmissions from the governing authority. Goa trance and its broad progeny has been the chief beneficiary of McKenna-esque. Sonic engineers excavate the archive for a trove of messages. Just as Each Static had done here on Prana from 1993.
We're not dropping out here. We're infiltrating and taking over.
The exemplar among electronic artists taking an interest in McKenna's elven sprechen is Spongle. A New Way to Say Hooray samples McKenna capturing the moment of contact following DMT inhalation.
So, you take, let us assume, a third toke, long and slow. You vaporize, and you take it in and in and in, and there is a sound like the crumpling of a plastic bread wrapper, or the crackling or the flame, and a tone, a then there is this, then there is this, then there is this. is a cheer. The gnomes have learned a new way to say who.
Later on the same track, Terence breaks into the elf chatter.
And so, like jeweled self-dribbling basketballs, these things come running forward, and what they are doing with this visible language that they create is they're making gifts for you. And they will say,
For over two decades, Spongle converted McKenna's voice into a sonic template for the unknown, transforming him into a medium, and many subsequent acts joined the party. Since there is often no overt meaning, the reproduction of McKenna, Alvin or otherwise, emphasizes his role as a medium of the unspeakable. The early recording collaborations and subsequent vocal remixes are designed to transmit the content, the message, of McKenna's visions. But more to the point, as audio artifacts, McKenna samples are designed not so much as a means to transmit any vocalized message, but to affect, narrate, and navigate transcendent psychedelic states. This is what I mean by McKenna-esque. Some artists in the psychedelic diaspora sample McKenna's message direct, notably his call for cognitive liberty.
People serve minds like their bodies. Must be a domain free from government control.
Others modify his voice to sound more elf-like.
The overwhelming phenomena in the world of three-dimensional space and time, and I call this the Omega Point, or the transcendental object at the end of history, and I believe it is not that far off that with the emergence of the global internet, a population of sound bills, an electronic atmosphere, we are now in the shadow.
While the elves became signature to the McKenna-esque aesthetic, it was McKenna's voice that signaled the transcendent, un-Englishable states of consciousness desired. Sometimes this condition is distinctly stated.
I go to a place where language finds it very hard to pull over, look around. It's almost as though it takes you to a world that is not English.
In some cases, the voice is sampled to declare the quality of the liminal conditions desired.
It's a strong trip.
Here, the voice further clarifies the desirable conditions. These are typically the only words sampled in tracks that are often 8 minutes long.
Where we really want to be is singing in the rainforest, naked, stoned, and exalted.
Other times, the voice provides indistinct chatter, perhaps not unlike audio-marked indistinct chatter in movie subtitle tracks. But with McKenna, the indistinct chatter is distinctly McKenna, a recognizable voice, even though the meaning may be occluded. So sometimes the distinctly indistinct voice is used to distinct effect. Yes.
To the mystery and DMT
as you are in the center of the bullseye. I mean, 30 seconds of the song DMT you approach.
It's difficult to come down from there, but in conclusion, Terence McKenna's explorations across multiple fields at the nexus of technology, religion, and consciousness has provided a catacomb of reference points for artists seeking to project sound that can be seen, read, tasted, felt. In the process, a McKenna-esque aesthetic has emerged in which McKenna became a medium for the psychedelic experience. That is to say, with his voice mined and refined from a vast archive within psychedelic electronica, downstream from his role of raving frontman, McKenna became a medium for the unspeakable. And so it's fitting that the final word should go to none other than the man himself.
This actually is simply one level of a cosmic system of some sort where birth and death are transitions from level to level. Things, intimations of immortality are vouchsafed by these plant hallucinogens. Why this should be, why it should be possible to get a look over the great divide, I have no idea.
So let's see if we have any questions. I personally was wondering if his, obviously his voice is heavily sampled in psychedelic genres or such as Goa trance, psytrance, or psybeant, and I was wondering if it pops up also in other electronic dance music genres. Do you have any awareness of that?
Yeah, that's a very good question. It may be because I listen to a vast range of psychedelic electronica, and I guess that crosses quite a large terrain, but I don't have ears on every dance floor, so to speak. So, I'm doubtful that his voice extends too far beyond, you know, psychedelic influenced and derived genres, and that's, you know, exclusively. I think Spongle is probably the best example, because Spongle was pretty much an emissary for McKenna and an emissary for DMT. In fact, I mean, and if you, I mean, it's hard to condense this kind of history into 15 minutes, and I could, you know, do an hour on Spongle alone, because they've got quite a lot of material to draw on. So, so the answer to your question is I don't think so. Maybe others have some responses to that, but I don't think so.
Yeah. Thanks. And we have another question here arising. Any thoughts about how Terence McKenna is able to record his experience with such detail and be so articulate about it?
He always claimed that mushrooms and actually more particular cannabis was essential for his, you know, his dialogical style. But as I'm documenting in my book, he was the kind of guy who, you know, could hold rooms in thrall right from, you know, from high school, you know, and when he moved to Berkeley, he was he just was able to rap with a style that was based on Dylan Thomas, actually. So he had this meter and style that he that derived from Dylan Thomas. And quite an extraordinary character, because, you know, he's the psychedelic intellectual whose main source of dissemination was, of course, his raps, his what I call his rapology, his style of speech. And I mean, he wrote some great books as well, including True Hallucinations, which was also a talking book, funnily enough, which was first published in 1984. But I've been having a lot of fun, you know, diving into the archives of you know, well over 500 hours worth material on record, and that's just the stuff that's survived. And there's more and more material. I just heard a couple of weeks ago his first recording in a chat he did in San Francisco in 72. So it's the oldest one, and even there, before he was well known, he was able to keep a very small, it's a very small group, but keep them wrapped. So yeah, he had a very, very rapturous style. So I think cannabis and then later on mushrooms were essential. But I think once he tried to give up smoking dope a couple of times, he kind of lost it, which is interesting.